Secretary's Chief of the Policy and Best Practices Service in the UN Departments of Peacekeeping Operation and Field Support. And this department was set up not too long ago and to provide the backup to the considerable number of UN peacekeeping operations. She previously led the team to implement Secretary General Ban Ki-moon's initiative on peace operations and the high-level panel on peace operations. And in fact, in the new Secretary General's commission, she is going to be a member of that on the peacekeeping commission, which he has set up when relatively recently, he has taken office in the 1st of January. She's worked on peace and security policy and operations at UN headquarters, including UN peace operations in Mali and Afghanistan, civilian capacities in peace operations, security sector reform, economic governance initiatives, and partnerships with regional organizations. And on the ground, she has served in UN peace operations in Syria, Afghanistan, Democratic Republic of Congo, and in Haiti. And before joining the UN in 2005, Renata was head of SIPRI, this Stockholm International Peace Research Institute program on armed conflict and conflict management. And prior to that, she was special advisor to the EU on the EU to the EU Council Secretariat for the planning of the first EU crisis management operation, and was deputy director of the East-West Institute European Security Programme from 1997 to 1999. Dr. Dwan has received her doctorate in philosophy from the University of Oxford and was a Fulbright scholar in Princeton. So, and she has also published widely on peacekeeping, international crisis management. That's a lengthy and very distinguished career leads us to welcome the thoughts and the address that she will give. Obviously, the peacekeeping operations are very much a front line for the UN. They're a highly visible operation of the UN functions. And over the seven decades, I think there have been over 120 states have contributed it. So it's a very widely seen and acknowledged arm of UN functions. And of course, it's particularly so in Ireland, where since 1958, we have continuously been sending troops abroad. And we see it here as very much a feature of our foreign policy, our contribution to peace and conflict resolution. But of course, there are huge challenges at the moment. The world has changed, the conflicts have changed, the actors have changed. So it will be of considerable interest to hear from you, Renata, of your view on peacekeeping in a divided world. What is the role of the UN?
Thank you very much, everyone, and it's a pleasure to be here today, and it's also a chance for me to come home, so that's even more of a nice experience. And coming from Athlone, as I do with the memorial to UN fallen peacekeepers, literally steps from my house, it is a very sort of personal meets professional always for me to be thinking about the role of Ireland in peacekeeping. I think where we are today in peacekeeping, in light of the current global environment, the surge in conflicts after a significant period of decline, the refugee crisis that has reached unparalleled required needs, and of course in size, and the perspective of the incoming administrations or elections in multiple countries, both in Europe and of course the new Trump administration, it's fair to say, are we at a time where it's the end of a commitment to global organizations and to peace and security efforts by global organizations? So I think these sorts of conversations are urgent, and they're going to become more urgent in the course of the years as we go ahead, as we move ahead into what is a very uncertain time. What I want to discuss today a little bit is currently in global environments, the UN, but also the EU, the World Bank, and other institutions, there's a lot of focus on peace building and how to sustain peace in fragile contexts. And you have institutions like the World Bank spending a lot of money in these areas. And you've seen last year the Security Council and the General Assembly agree a groundbreaking resolution on sustaining peace, which is sort of a commitment to look much more at the bookends of conflict, the prevention side before the conflict and after the conflict breaks out. And a feeling that we've spent too much time thinking about the conflict phase and that we need to spend much more time thinking about the prevention and the sustaining peace of the conflicts. So this is also a priority for the new Secretary General, who has come in on an agenda of prevention and on trying to do much more to sustain peace on either side, and a call to people to stop having just a crisis response and just a sort of when the crisis is at its hottest, then to say, now we have to do something. So that has been sort of the current mood and some of the debates, both in the academic world and certainly in the policy world at multilateral institutions. Now, in some cases, this is almost seen as an alternative to peacekeeping. Let's move in this peace-building direction and let's sort of, this peacekeeping thing, let's leave it aside. Now, what I want to argue today is that it's a mistake to approach peacekeeping and peace-building as two separate entities, but that they're essentially intertwined. Peacekeeping is an essential component of any peace-building, and successful peacekeeping relies on incorporating a peace-building approach. And I want to argue that as we go forward in what is going to be a very rocky year ahead, we are going to have to rethink what we mean by peace-building and how what we mean by peacekeeping in that. So where is the mood on peacekeeping? Well, if you look at the numbers alone, as Mari suggested, it looks pretty good. 125 countries participating in it. 16 missions around the world, 118,000 people participating in UN peacekeeping, of which 100,000 are military and police. That is a significant global operation. 7 decades long, perception of international legitimacy and longevity. So does that story look pretty good? And of course you had under the Obama administration a commitment of the US to come behind peacekeeping, and you've had 3 years of successive fairly high global summits on peacekeeping to increase the base of peacekeeping. You've had Obama even chair one of them. And you have, of course, last year in London, the third peacekeeping summit. Budget high, some $8 billion. And now you've seen increasingly in the last couple of years the return of Europeans to peacekeeping. I don't mean Ireland or Sweden and countries that have traditionally maintained, but I'm talking about Germany and the Netherlands. And so coming back to peacekeeping after a significant period of non-participation. So that looks pretty good, perhaps. The signs are that it's a tool that has acceptability and people are participating in it. Now, if you look at the research side of things, which, of course, being good international civil servants, we rarely do any empirical basis or grounding on research. But if you do look at that, the research also points to correlating data that peacekeeping in countries emerging from conflict tends to reduce the chances of that country falling back into conflict. And, of course, for those of you who are students, you'll know that work, Doyle and Sambanis from 2000, Paige Fortner from 2006. So essentially, it's also saying, on the whole, peacekeepers tend to go to more violent conflicts where that have been going on for longer. And on the whole, the data demonstrates that where peacekeepers are deployed, the chances of falling back into conflict are reduced. So that's perhaps a good story. And is that a good news story? Well, if you were in New York today, or perhaps in the media of any one of our countries, that's not how it looks. There is a perception, fairly widespread perception, that peacekeeping is in trouble and or even failing. And there's very multiple factors that have led to that. One, of course, is the significant problem around sexual exploitation and abuse by peacekeepers in mission areas. That may be undertaken by a small number of peacekeepers, but it has cast a negative light on the conduct of peacekeepers, on the accountability, and on the ability of the UN to manage. And it's significant because at the moment in the US Congress, there are bills about cutting funding for the UN for various factors, but one of which is because of the problem of sexual exploitation and abuse. So that has cast a dark cloud in public perceptions and the idea whether the UN can control its peacekeepers. A second issue, of course, is the cost. We're still emerging from a global financial recession. Context is difficult, and $8 billion seems like a lot of money. It is a lot of money, even if it's less than half of 1% of world military expenditure. It It is paid through compulsory assessed budget contributions of member states, and that has been a constraint. Another area that I think is a perception of it's not working is the idea that somehow it's maybe what you might call the dog that doesn't bark. People now, and I've just come back from UNIFIL last week, to look at a mission in response to a Security Council perception that, you know, it's costing a lot of money and the place seems pretty peaceful, and like, why should we be keeping a lot of troops and money and material out there? Well, maybe the troops and the material that are out there are contributing to that peace, but it's a little bit difficult to demonstrate that argument. So it's a bit like the dog that didn't bark. Is it because of the peacekeepers there that it's quiet? So demonstrating success isn't always easy. There is a perception of protracted conflict recovery, how long it takes for a country to get back on track. Look at Haiti and Liberia, where the past 2 years we've been successively trying to close those missions and downsize them. And there's a perception of, are they ready yet? Is it always too fragile to move in beyond a departure of peacekeeping? Certainly the president of Liberia continues to argue that the presence of UN police is absolutely essential for the stability of the country. And similar, you get a similar tension in Haiti. And then, of course, you've got the very difficult contexts of South Sudan in particular, but also Sudan and DRC, where the presence of peacekeepers takes place amongst that all-out violence, as in the case of South Sudan, or significant political crisis like the Congo. So when you combine that with a sense of the cost and the record, there's a perception of, we deploy these troops, we deploy all these operations, and why is there not a sustainable peace and a recovery in the country concerned? The reality is also, too, that the UN is being deployed into more and more intense and violent conflicts. If you think about Mali and the mission there, which was deployed in the light of perceived Islamic threat by Islamic extremist organizations, if you look at the countries like Somalia, where AU peacekeepers are authorized by the UN to deploy against the threat of Al-Shabaab, the perception that UN peacekeeping is more and more being deployed to intense ongoing conflicts where there is no peace to keep and where the threat is coming from armed groups that have no desire to participate in a political process and indeed are targeting the UN. So I think these sets of issues have left a lot of doubt and a fundamental crisis of confidence amongst many in what's the purpose of peacekeeping and where and how it should continue to play a role in the future. I think a consequence of that crisis of confidence has been, you've seen, increased political tensions between member states about what they think peacekeeping should do. So if you look at the Security Council and the debates over renewals of mandate, debates over what peacekeepers should do in DRC, whether protection of civilians should be a task for peacekeeping, whether the UN peacekeepers should engage in reform of state institutions, that's become a tension between Security Council members who are themselves divided as never before. It's become a tension between the Security Council and the troop contributing countries who say, we're the ones sending our troops to undertake the mandates that you yourselves have defined but are not willing to send troops to. It's created tension between the peacekeeping operations and the whole state, where there is a perception that that sovereignty is being interfered. If you look at countries like South Sudan or like DRC, which has for 3 years running PNG'd, in other words, sent out, persona non grata, the head of the human rights component of the mission. So that tension in terms of what the mission is mandated to do and what the whole state is willing to accept or do has left a sense that there's a political loss of unity. There's also, I think, particularly in light of the dangerous environments of peacekeeping today, an increasing focus on the military operations and the activities. That's partly a consequence of the environments and the very dangerous environments that peacekeepers are going into. It's partly a consequence of the lack of political unity, which, faced with a lack of political unity, the focus then becomes military activities, stability efforts, protection of civilians. I do want to flag that, ironically, the return of the Europeans to peacekeeping, in my view, has increased a little bit that tendency to take a very much military focus on operations. And I think that's partly that many of those countries are coming from a NATO experience, in Iraq and Afghanistan, perhaps not as institutionalized in the culture as perhaps Irish troops or even Swedish or Finnish troops, in the culture of having a civilian command and of working side by side with civilians. So that has led to, I think, an increased focus on operations, military capabilities, performance of the military side. And that you see in the council today with its focus on debates around use of force and the drive to get more enablers and capabilities. So where do we see that spanning out? I mentioned Lebanon last week. You see the council wanting to cut all community outreach activities, or some on the council, I should say. You see them saying, and the driver for that being, why are the troops doing these sorts of community outreach, civilian activities? Let's revise that. You see China in the budgetary processes not approving any political affairs officers or looking at human rights activities and saying, why do we need that in a peacekeeping operation? You see Russia fairly seriously opposed to any references to human rights mandates and to capacities and normative engagement on human rights issues in peacekeeping operations. And you see real tensions over extensions of mandates, whether Liberia should continue to benefit from a peacekeeping operation or not. So that's where I think some of these tensions are back. What I want to argue here is that the implications of this division and this implication of understanding peacekeeping increasingly as a kinetic and operational military-driven activity is not good neither for peacekeeping and for the political cohesion behind it, but not good either for practical peace-building and the effect and the capability of the UN intervention to contribute to peace. Let's go back again to statistics for a minute. If you look at the data analysis, the data has looked at the types of operations and what are more likely to contribute to peace. So Paige Fortner has looked at this over time and found that multidimensional operations, in other words, operations that include police, civilian, military components, that include political, human rights, civil affairs, community activities, disarmament, and all those activities that go alongside a significant effort, have had more chance to maintain peace than more traditional limited military ceasefire monitoring missions. And interestingly, the data is also pointing that to the success of peacekeeping is mainly due to its non-military mechanisms. So the decision of armed groups not to go back to war and to keep the peace is about changing the incentives of violence, alleviating fear, building more trust, avoiding accidental escalation into war. And while these are important things that the military contributes to, they're also critically led by political processes and efforts to change perspectives, views, and incentives. So we understand, therefore, peacekeeping as primarily a political tool that draws on and uses important military and police assets, security assets, but that is not in and of itself a military tool for the purposes of military objectives. So security is critical for any peacekeeping, for any peacebuilding activity, and peacekeepers do contribute to that effort by creating an enabling environment. But the idea that somehow that a military and security perspective and a political and peacebuilding perspective can be separate is blatantly demonstrated by all our experiences so far to be not the case. Some have said then, well, why do we pay for expensive peacekeeping? We could perhaps put that money into aid, development aid, humanitarian aid, and drive, tackle poverty and the root causes of conflict that might lead to conflict. Well, again, the literature is mixed on that one. There is not any indication at the moment that aid has a significant effect in stabilizing post-conflict situations. It has a moderate effect, but not a significant effect. So the idea somehow that putting money, just development aid alone and in and of itself, will not necessarily achieve stability. So what we're coming back to is, how do we have this integrated approach of a political, security, development, and human rights component? Therefore, I would argue then that peace building and a peacekeeping approach to peacebuilding is critical for the success of the peacebuilding effort and for the success of the peacekeeping operation. But we will need to approach it differently in the new world in which we now work on. Maybe first, a couple of elements as to what would be a new or a understanding and approach to peacebuilding in a peacekeeping, in a new peacekeeping context. The first, I think, would be the need to rethink some of the drivers of conflict. Up until perhaps the Arab Spring, there was a direct correlation often made between poverty and conflict. Poor poverty leads to conflict. And so we found ourselves then a bit nonplussed when Syria happened and when the Arab Spring happened, where you saw countries that, according to poverty development indexes, were middle-income countries or approaching middle-income status erupting in conflict. And likewise, you have conflict, you have countries like Malawi, countries fairly low down on the conflict in the development index that have not had conflict. So we've had to rethink, what does the link between poverty and conflict? We know that poverty creates conditions that can result in people using violence, armed violence. And we know that sudden shocks in a country, the collapse of the gold industry, or if it's a mining country, the collapse of mining, can create shocks that a country can't manage to overcome. But more and more we've become aware of, from the Arab Spring on, that when we think about conflict, we're looking at the relative inequality between communities and societies in a conflict, and that exclusion and inclusion of communities and societies in the state's governance and in the state's resources tends to have a much more significant correlation for chances of violence and violence. So for those of you, of course, who follow some of the development debates, you'll have seen in the Sustainable Development Goals this emphasis now on inclusion, and that inclusive societies stand a greater chance of peace and of avoiding and managing crises than non-inclusive societies. So if we were to approach that understanding from peacekeeping, what does that mean and how might that affect where we might not look? Well, one thing it would change is the emphasis of the state-building experiment that we see in Iraq and Afghanistan. So if we think about Iraq and Afghanistan and the ISAF, the International Security Assistance Force, the American-led effort in both countries, we saw there massive exercises to rebuild entire states. We saw emphasis on recreating an army from scratch in the case of Iraq, significant creation of new police forces in Afghanistan. We saw the overhauling of the constitution in Afghanistan. We saw the complete reform of justice, redesign of everything from taxation to functioning of health and environment institutions. That process and that outcome has not necessarily yielded success, and it's a super long process that will inevitably take decades. So the extent to which the nation-building approach is the right way to building peace is under question. That is not to say that strong functioning states aren't essential to maintaining states' peace and stability and human rights. Absolutely. The focus is more on, should the job of a peacekeeping or an international intervention be on building state institutions or on looking at other aspects of the community? And in particular, the extent to which trust exists between state and societies and communities. I'll give you an example from my time in Afghanistan. The World Bank was running a massive financial Ministry of Finance support overhaul to build the financial ministries. That was a huge undertaking that began at the central level to get a Ministry of Finance functioning and start a budgetary process working. But in the course of that process, when you would say to the bank officials, what does that mean for a local community to have any budgets coming for any local civil service functions anytime in the next 3 to 5 years? They would say, no, we're not ready yet. It'll come, but it'll take some time. But if you're in a peacekeeping context and in a context of fragile stability, is that sufficient to engage and to create the basis for a recovery and for a sustainable peace? It's one of the questions we're looking at in Central African Republic right now. So if we were to look at a new and a slightly different peace-building approach, one, I think, of the key issues would be that we have a little bit more focus on the local level and on the subnational of building community engagement, building confidence of communities, and building trust between communities and central state representatives. And that's, I think, a critical role for UN peacekeepers, not just because they're often out in the field offices where nobody else is and where few development actors are present, and certainly no embassies and certainly no international financial institutions, but it's also a critical component of part of the efforts that we have to engage with the community as much for our own safety and security as elsewhere. So whether and how we might look at more local community incentives and community rebuilding is, I think, going to be a big question. And it's going to be a sensitive question because it's at the heart of states and state sovereignty and state institutions. And for example, when we engage now in Central African Republic with community building initiatives and community engagements initiatives, that has some sensitivity for the state, which would like to sort of see an immediate establishment of its institutions and focus. So that's one key issue. The second, I think, focus that we're going to have to look at is a whole new way of working with development and humanitarian partners. Now, the UN for the last two decades has been talking about integration between development, human rights, and humanitarian. NATO has its comprehensive approach. The EU has its comprehensive approaches to crisis management too. But I wonder, and I would just put it out there, whether we have really advanced significantly on those efforts. Every national country still has its siloed pools for financing. We still have our siloed programmatic activities. The development budget doesn't mix with the security budget, the political budget. So we're very much still funding and programming and engaging these as entirely separate functions. And while much of the focus of the efforts of UN peacekeeping to work better with development and humanitarian human rights actors for the last 10 years has progressed, it's been internally UN-focused. Whereas if you look at the amount of money that comes into a country in a post-conflict, 80% of it, 85% of it, goes outside the UN. So in other words, even if we have perfect coordination with all our UN partners, the real money is coming from outside actors, the EU, the World Bank, development banks, and bilateral donors. So that really gets at the issue of how can then the UN really and UN peacekeeping really work in a much more strategic and operational way with other actors. And I'm highlighting in particular the World Bank, the European Union, and key donors at the level of programming and at the level of activities. And finally, I would flag that a newer area of peacekeeping that we're going to have to look at is having a leaner and more effective peacekeeping mandate should not mean that it's therefore a lean military component, but that we look at the leanness as an ability to think about critical peacebuilding tasks and equip ourselves to deliver on them. I raise all this because I think Ireland's particularly well-placed to drive some of these issues of the new peace-building tasks in a divided world. First, you've been amongst the most supportive of this comprehensive effort and at the nexus between development and security. But second, you've also been a driving force between the EU and the UN and driving some of that cooperation in crisis management. So looking forward to a moment that is potentially a moment of crisis for the EU with Brexit and with a lot of discussions about the future of European security and defence, and looking to questions about the future of UN peacekeeping, I wonder if it's not a moment for countries like Ireland to really come in behind helping to define a new approach to peacebuilding that recognises the challenges and the very real challenges of building peace in conflict and after conflict, but avoids the tendency to make that simply understood as a military task.